For some reason, there isn't much more of a lightning rod topic these days than the vaccine for COVID-19. Everybody's become experts in immunology, virology, pulmonology, and any other ology that you can imagine. Because of that, there's so many different ideas that you're subjected to that you probably don't know what to believe. Well, in this video, we're going to go over some of the most common concerns that are brought up in regards to the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines and let you know why I decided to get it and why it may be a good idea for you too. Hi, I'm Dr. Eric Richardson, a board-certified family practice physician. I'd like to welcome you to Family Med, a channel that focuses on giving you practical and accurate medical information to help you and your family. Now, if you think this will be something that's helpful to you, make sure you subscribe, hit that notification button, and follow along with us. So this is a video that I've known that I needed to make for a while, but honestly, I haven't been too excited about doing it. Not that I don't think this is an important topic, I think it's a vital topic. It's just that here in the United States, at least, it has turned into the craziest political subject that, frankly, I just don't get. Now, you add on that talking about vaccines, look out. I can already hear the comments coming out of the woodworks on how I'm advocating poison, I'm trying to control the world, I'm part of the big pharma conspiracy, that I'm just saying what I'm saying because of all the big pharma kickbacks that I'm getting, and on and on and on. All I have to say about that is it's garbage. There's nobody pulling my strings. There's no such thing as a big pharma kickback. If there was, I promise you, I'd be enjoying these perks sitting on a beach instead of living in freezing cold Idaho talking about this right now. If you don't believe in vaccines, if you think us doctors are all out to get you, then you're just wasting your time. Go ahead and click off. Don't bother putting any comments down below. Go find some forums of like-minded people. Enjoy your time there. If, however, you're honestly seeking answers and looking to see if this is the right thing for you and your family, hopefully what I have to say will help you in your decision. Nobody's making you get it. But I'm going to tell you why I got it, and maybe you should too. First of all, the reason we need this vaccine is that it's the only reliable way that we have right now of getting all of our lives back to normal. I'm sick of wearing masks and social distancing, having my kids not in school all the time, just like everybody else. But there's no way to achieve safely the type of herd immunity that will make this virus burn out without a vaccine. To allow it to spread unabated through our communities has been, and will continue to be, a total disaster. It is the only way that we can get our friends and family who are high risk out of their houses and enjoying life. It's the only way to be able to reliably get all of our schools open and avoid having all the restrictions on businesses and our economy that this has caused. It's the only way to stop the current known and unknown issues and complications that have been arising from those getting infected. There still isn't any reliable treatment or prevention that we can confidently get behind that is going to get us out of this. We know vaccines work. I understand as well everybody's reservation with putting something new in their bodies, that this feels like maybe it's been something that's been rushed. So let's talk about these concerns to see if I can help you answer some of your questions. The first concern that most have had regarding these vaccines is that they are so new. At the time of filming this video, there are two vaccines that are approved under an emergency use authorization in the United States and most of the world. These are the ones manufactured by Pfizer and Moderna. The biggest concern many have is this process has been rushed too quickly, and corners may have been cut to get this out and approved. The fact of the matter is that this process went faster than usual because we've been in a deadly global health crisis, and more scientific effort and dollars have been put into this problem than any other in recent memory. Because of that, much of the bureaucracy, red tape, and all the other impediments that government usually messes things up with have gotten taken away. Much of the time that goes into getting approvals for any treatment are spent sitting on some bureaucrat's desk. We all complain about how inefficient government can be, but when they actually help instead of getting in the way, we become suspicious. This whole process has been faster than usual, but it doesn't mean that corners were cut. It still followed all the steps for testing and review. Now, the main reasons for all this speed boils down to several things. First, that we've developed more modern scientific tools that are faster than the old ones. There's also been a worldwide effort to remove or reduce barriers that cause delays in research, production, and distribution, as well as we've had a large number of brave, ordinary people who volunteered for clinical trials that have been able to give us safety and efficacy data. It usually takes months to years to get enough people to volunteer to get enough numbers to even do the trials. They still went through all the same review processes, had all the same questions asked by independent reviewers who are intent and making sure this is a safe and effective vaccine. There has never been a more scrutinized vaccine than these. If these don't work or cause significant problems, then trust in vaccines and the medical community would be irreparably harmed. there is no motivation for these agencies to take unnecessary risks. Another reason why this went so fast is also one of the concerns that people have had for this vaccine. And that has to do with the technology that is being used by the leading vaccines right now that uses what we call mRNA. mRNA stands for messenger ribonucleic acid. Let me give you a quick explanation of what this is so you can know what we're talking about. mRNA is a little protein that your body produces from the DNA. DNA is like the blueprint for our body. And mRNA is like a little photocopy of a part of that DNA that leaves the center part of the cell called the nucleus into the liquid part of the cell called the cytoplasm. What the MRI does is it finds some workhorse proteins in the cytoplasm called ribosomes. And when they get together, the mRNA tells the ribosomes what kind of proteins to make. This is something that our body is doing day in and day out to allow our bodies to function. Now, what scientists have found out that if we're able to make mRNA, we can use that to tell the body to produce specific proteins. In the case of coronavirus, they've taken the DNA code of the virus, took a little part out of it, and made a little blueprint in the form of this mRNA. By them giving this to our bodies, it tells the ribosomes in our cells to produce a piece of the virus, a small protein that the body can recognize and make antibodies to fight it. Within a few days, the mRNA in the vaccine is actually destroyed, and all that's left over is the antibodies that your body has produced, just like as if it had been exposed to the actual virus. The mRNA never enters the control part of the cell called the nucleus, and it doesn't change your DNA. It just allows your body to recognize what part of the virus would look like without ever being exposed your body to that virus. Now, the cool part of the technology and why this has been able to happen so fast is that once you know a DNA sequence of something, you can produce the mRNA very quickly. In other vaccines, we're trying to take the virus and inactivate it or make it otherwise safe, it's a much longer process. In this case, the time between when they got the DNA sequence to when they had the first mRNA code that they could start testing was only around 40 days. That's a modern day miracle. And that's the whole goal in developing this technology, to be able to rapidly develop a vaccine to combat emerging virus threats throughout the world. Many have likened this technology to a drill. It's a vehicle that you can plug in any number of different things in order to be able to get its desired effect. It really is an amazing technology. Now, one of the biggest concerns that many have had that this is so new, and although that's true, that this is the first time it has been used and approved to be used on a mass scale like this, and of course we've never used it on the coronavirus before, but this is not entirely new technology. In fact, one of the areas that this has been studied the most in over the past several years is in the realm of cancer treatments. Immunotherapy is one of the most exciting areas of cancer treatments that's being researched. There have been multiple human trials using mRNA vaccines to treat different types of cancer, all showing this technology to be safe. Obviously, there is more study to be done, but what we've seen in the past trials, as well as the current safety that we're seeing with the millions who have received the coronavirus vaccine so far, the risk of not getting it appears to be much greater than getting it. So let's talk about the side effects that are being seen. The most common effects that we're seeing are short fever, headaches, fatigue, chills, and the sore arm. These are common effects that we see with many different vaccinations. Now, the reason we're getting these symptoms is the exact reason we're giving the shot, to give your body the opportunity to form an immune response so that it can fight off and prevent future infection. This is a good thing. We're seeing that with the first injection for both the Pfizer and the Moderna vaccine tends to be more mild, with the second injection bringing on a more active response than the first. So the second shot, you may feel worse, but most state that these symptoms last for just a day and then go away. All these symptoms are usually easily treated with over-the-counter ibuprofen or acetaminophen. In my experience, I got the Moderna vaccine at the end of December. After getting the first shot, other than some arm soreness, I really didn't feel much. But at the time of this filming, I haven't had my second shot yet, so I'll keep you posted on how that went. Now, just because I didn't have any problems, of course, doesn't mean that you will or won't. Okay, but my reaction and my experience is probably more common than not. So let's talk about some of the more significant side effects that have been noted. The main one that we have heard the most about are the allergic reactions. These are still very rare, but for those who it's been happening to, it seems to be more common for those who have had anaphylaxis or a severe allergic reaction to other things. So for now, we're recommending those who find to have this issue to talk to your doctor about whether they think you should get it. If you're known to be allergic to any component of the injection, of course, you should avoid using it as well. Otherwise, most places give the injection will observe you for 15 to 30 minutes for signs of an allergic reaction. If you're going to have a problem with it, it will most likely be within that 30 minutes. If after getting the injection, though, you start noticing hives, swelling in the throat or lips, difficulty breathing, or otherwise feeling unwell right after, seek care immediately. Allergic reactions are simple to treat, but you need to get these seen soon. There have also been a few reports of Bell's palsy after getting the vaccine. Now, this is a condition where half of your face will start to feel numb and droop. It's most commonly caused by viral infections. In the studies, a few cases were found, but they were found in similar numbers with those getting the placebo shot as well. This is a normally occurring condition, so it wasn't felt to happen in any more frequent than usual, leading to the conclusion that these cases are not likely due to the vaccine. Now, this is one thing we should be careful about as we listen to the news. With as much scrutiny that is on this, and as much as the media's loving to report on every little thing, inevitably you're going to see reports of this thing happening and this person got the shot, or this person died and they got the shot. Now, we need to remember that normally people get sick. They die from all sorts of things. Just because they got the shot right before doesn't mean that that's the cause. So far, several millions have gotten the shot throughout the world with very few severe side effects. As far as long term, what are my thoughts? Well, nobody's had the vaccine in their arm for more than 9 months, so to be honest, we can't answer this for sure. However, when you look at the safety data from prior studies, using the same technology, as well as understanding how the vaccine actually works, especially the fact that it does not stay in the body for very long after the injection, there's a high degree of confidence that long-term concerns will be minimal. In the meantime, the threat of COVID-19 is real and killing thousands throughout the United States and the world every day, and leaving many others with lasting symptoms and disability. Now, the last area that I've been hearing a lot about is possible effects on pregnancy and fertility. First with pregnancy. We still can't make any official claims on safety as there's not been any studies done with pregnant women. There were about 26 women who got pregnant during the Pfizer study, and they have done well, but this isn't enough to prove anything. Looking at the technology, though, and how things work with these vaccines, there aren't any red flags or issues that we would expect to cause problems. But since it hasn't been studied, we can't say for sure. There are some concerns floating the internet around that a protein called syncytin 1 found in the placenta has some biological similarities to the protein that is targeted with the COVID vaccine. Because of that, there's claims that will cause anywhere from harm to the baby to infertility. The simple answer to this is, when looked at, these proteins are not the same. It would not cause an immune response that would endanger the mother or the baby. Subsequent studies are now underway where pregnant women are being enrolled in trials. What we do know is that pregnancy puts women in a higher risk category for having severe COVID infections. In fact, the death rate for COVID in pregnant women is twice that of non-pregnant women. Because of that, the American College of Obstetrics and Gynecology has recommended that it be made available to pregnant women and that you have a frank and open discussion with your doctor about whether it's right for you. Other claims such as infertility or impotence as well have no basis in truth because there isn't so far valid scientific basis to raise that concern. In fact, there is some mounting evidence that infection with COVID-19 can affect sperm count, possibly affecting male fertility. So getting the vaccine has the potential to help protect you from this. So after all that I've been able to gather from good, reliable sources, I felt that the risk of getting the vaccine was much lower than the risk that we are currently under as this pandemic rages on. It really is our best hope to being able to get out of this pandemic sooner with fewer lives lost and less impact on our businesses, schools, and family. Spreading unneeded fear in regards to the vaccine use is just going to make this problem worse. As a physician, I see firsthand the impact that COVID has been having on my patients. I've had healthy young patients who can now barely carry on a conversation with me without getting short of breath months after their infection. I've had many with lingering chest pain, headaches, and fatigue. I've even seen an otherwise healthy 40-year-old develop diabetes within a week of having a mild case of COVID. I've had several patients die who would not have otherwise done so at this time. But almost more than that, the greater impact that I've seen are my elderly and at-risk population, who, because there is such higher risk of having severe problems, haven't been able to safely leave their house or interact with loved ones for over a year. We need a rapid solution to this problem, and the more of us that can get it, the quicker we all go back to normal. I understand that many have their own ideas about this, but let's really try and get away from the politics that has unfortunately entered into this very non-political issue. Let's regain a little trust of those professionals who have dedicated their lives to research and who know what they're talking about. I hear all the time that people did their own research, but in reality, all that research entailed is searching for and gravitating towards information that already supports what you already think. When you look at the data, all things point to this being an absolute miracle of modern science. In my own personal opinion, divine providence that has given us the tools to get this under control. We're all anxious to be done with this, and have been praying for it to come to pass. As I look at this situation, though, it reminds me of an old story that I heard in church once about a guy who was drowning in the ocean praying for help. As he's praying for help, a small boat comes offering a hand. The man with much faith refuses the help, stating that he's waiting for God to save him. This happens two different times with different boats passing by, offering a hand, and each time he refuses for the same reason. The story goes on that he gets to the pearly gates after he drowns, of course, and he's a little irritated that God didn't save him. God answers, of course, to him, was that he tried to save him by sending him all those boats, but he was too blind to see it for what it is. I wonder if we're doing the same thing with this. We know that taking proper precautions like wearing masks, maintaining distances, being smart about our social interactions, and now taking the vaccine will work. Hopefully we can all see this as an answer to those prayers and get this pandemic behind us. Well, if you made it this far, thanks for watching. It's a longer video than I usually do, but there's a lot of important information to cover. But hopefully it's helped you feel a little more comfortable about getting the shot. We've all been through a lot this past year, and we hope and pray that this next year will be better for you. Hopefully you found this to be helpful, and if you did, please take time to give this video a like and share it with your friends. It really does help our channel to grow and reach other people that may need this in their life. And if you haven't done so yet, don't leave without subscribing and hitting that notification button so you don't miss out on any of your future content. Well, until next time, this is Family Med with Dr. Richardson, and remember, take care of your body, because it's the only one you have.